It's time for Lunar New Year! We're Chinese New Year. Lunar New Year, it kind of involves every single people group in Asia, but then Chinese New Year is only people, Taiwanese, Chinese ethnicity.
You guys have your own New Year?
Yeah, we get together with family, have a big dinner, there's decorations, dragon dances, fireworks. I mean, you should see how crazy it gets in Chinatown. If you can breathe properly the next day, you weren't there.
Today we're going to be comparing that with Passover. Chinese New Year is one of the most important holidays in Asia. And the period around it has often been called the largest annual human migration in the world. It beats all the other massive human migrations that there are, like the Hajj, yeah, I don't know about many actually massive human migrations. So first we're gonna cover Chinese New Year, and then we're gonna move on to the Passover. And there's three things we saw that were kind of neat that they have in common. Maybe neat's the wrong word. First, they both have a terrifying child-devouring creature. So Chinese New Year has a cultural story about a village that's attacked regularly by this thing called the Nian. By regularly, we mean every single year, and the pictures of the Nian may vary. Some people say it's kind of ox-like and lion-like, and what we do know is the Nian is this angry, fierce, just mean creature who kind of comes down from the mountains and he's like, I'm gonna eat your children! Rawr! The story of the Nian is basically that as it's going every year to go eat this village and people are scared, that at some point they realize the Nian is afraid of three things: the color red, fire, and loud noises. Which firecrackers kind of two of those in one, so especially if they're red, everything. So the story goes that the village actually uses these three things, fire, loud noises, and the color red, and the Nian sees them, and they're like, ah, they're wearing red, ah, they've got pots and pans, they're banging them. It gets scared, it runs to the mountains, doesn't bother them again. Although it might come back again, so you gotta protect against it, you know what I mean, right there? And so the Nian significantly eats less children. So the word Nian means year, and Guo Nian means to kind of like the Nian passes over. So there's this idea of like every year the Nian beast, which eats people, passes over them. My favorite version of this story comes from the Beijing tourism website. So it involves this monk, Lao Tzu, and he comes to a village in China. And he finds a man and he's like, why are you so sad? And the man's like, haven't you heard? The Nian comes and eats us every year. And so the monk's like, I'm a reason with this guy. Lao Tzu approaches the Nian and he's like, Nian, I have come to reason with you. Stop eating and terrorizing the people of China. And the Nian replies, you brought yourself to me, old man. Now I will eat you. And Lao Tzu's like, what'll that prove? Eating me isn't great. Would you dare to eat the poisonous mountain snakes? And the Nian does that, does a couple more things. So then Nian comes and he's like, old man, now it's time for me to eat you. And Lao Tzu's like, okay, just wait while I take my clothes off. I'm gonna taste much better. So old man takes off his clothes and he's wearing red underwear. And the Nian's like, ah, red undergarment. I dearly hate red. Get out of my sight quickly. That's a direct quote from the website. And then Lao Tzu's like, ha ha ha, I knew you were afraid of red. Then he goes into town and he's like, dear villagers, don't be afraid. He's terrified of red, but from now on, every single house is gonna have to paste red on their doors every year to prevent this Nian from coming and wreaking havoc. And then after that, they start to put red paper on the doors. This brings us to door frames. So during Chinese New Year, they use what are called spring couplets. Now, if you're from the West, you've probably seen this at a Chinese restaurant or if you've been to Chinatown. If you're Taiwanese and you haven't seen this, maybe tell us in the comments below because I'd be very interested to see how you couldn't see it when they're everywhere. Every New Year, people put up these red couplets and they have different poems. They can be very beautiful. What they do is they bring some sort of fortune or good luck to you for the year, but also they scare away spirits and ghosts. Some people also say it's to scare away the Nian and they connect that with that story, but we don't have a lot of written documents to really prove that. So I'm not gonna make these outrageous claims that the red door frame is always about the Nian, but it might be about the Nian. So most sources I found seem to show the spring couplets arriving around the 14th century, and they're the evolution of what they call the taofu. And the taofu are these little things they'd hang from peach trees, made often from peach wood, and they're charms that would scare away spirits and monsters. The third thing that they have in common is family gatherings and food and community in this sort of celebratory event. Now, that's a very bad way to term that, but basically it's a gathering of a lot of people come together for this event. So in Chinese New Year, one of the most important things is the reunion meal. And your family gets together, multiple generations, and sometimes you'll go to your in-laws on one side, and the next day you go to the other in-laws. But your entire family decides to gather together, eat a meal, stay up really late, they'll share stories, there's a lot of time off, people don't go to work. This reunion meal is very important, and the idea is to keep the mood really happy and celebratory. They've got a lot of special foods and traditions around the foods, so maybe you'll have a dumpling and find a coin in it when you bite in, and that might give you fortune or good luck for the coming year. I mean, I would probably break my tooth on it, but it's different.
好了,一口,嗯,嗯,有嗎?有嗎?嗯,是不是?恭喜發財。哇!
They might serve food that looks a certain way, like egg rolls are shaped a little bit like old gold bars from back in the day. Ingots, I love ingots. Wish I had more ingots. It's just this loving, happy time of celebrating family and community and building those relationships. It's that time where we compare and contrast. Passover, for those who don't know, is one of the most important holidays in Judaism. The Passover is in the book of Exodus, and it's the story of the Jewish people and how they left Egypt. Now, they were in Egypt for 400 years as slaves. And it was really brutal work, and there was even genocide done towards their people. So God raises up this person, Moses, and Moses is supposed to set the Jewish people free to help the Israelites escape from slavery. So God sends Moses to Pharaoh, who is the king of Egypt, and basically says, you're gonna tell him that I'm gonna send plagues his way, and if he doesn't listen, his place is gonna get wrecked.
I'm talking about the time Moses said to Pharaoh, let my people go, and Pharaoh went, in your dreams. And Moses called to God going, God, I need some help. And frogs fell from the sky.
So Moses continues to go to Pharaoh and basically keep telling him, hey, you gotta let my people go. And when he doesn't, a plague will happen. Like we have gnats, we have locusts. And you see that slowly the economy and the entire way of living of the Egyptians is getting destroyed, their cattle's dying. Eventually it all culminates in this really, really scary plague where there's an angel of death that's gonna come. And that's where we get to the first thing that they have in common. So the Israelites, they're told that they'd be visited by the angel of death. Like a Taiwanese hell deity, like this angel of death isn't like good or bad, he's just doing his job. So the angel's gonna come and kill the firstborn child of every family. It's horrific. And that leads us to our second thing, which is oddly enough very similar, which is red door frames. So God said the Israelites could take a pure, unblemished lamb and sacrifice it, and they take its blood and then they wipe it over the mantle of the door frame. And this would be a signal for the angel of death to pass over. It would basically say that this person believes in the God of Israel, he understands what the God of Israel is commanding, and don't do any harm to him. So it happens, the angel of death comes, and there's tons of death. The firstborn dies in every single family except those who have the blood of the lamb. And through this, Pharaoh is finally fed up. It's the 10th time that he's just been destroyed by this God who keeps saying, Pharaoh, let these people go. So he relents and he says, get out of here, Moses. Take your people, get away.
That's it, Hebrews, get out!
The Passover story is something that's really kind of scary, but also really beautiful. Every year, Jewish families gather together, and kind of like the reunion dinner, one of the highlights and most important parts of being Jewish is gathering together with your family and doing what's called a Seder. And a Seder is a very elaborate ceremonial storytelling of the Passover. And they focus on what happened during it. They focus on different things with the food. So maybe they'll taste something like salt that reminds them of the tears that they had and the bitter moments. Or they'll eat bread which isn't leavened because they want to be reminded of the fact that they had to flee so fast that they didn't have time to even take leavened bread. What's incredible is that event happened more than 3,000 years ago, and to this day, it's celebrated regularly every year. Do you have a favorite Lunar New Year tradition? Are you Jewish? I don't know if we have a big Jewish audience, but do you celebrate Passover? Tell us in the comments below. I'd encourage you to go into the Old Testament and find those festivals and really say, you know, what were they celebrating and what did this mean? And identify with it the same way you would identify with a holiday of your own. If you do, leave us a comment about how understanding the stories of the Old Testament has helped you grow in your faith. We're so grateful for you as our audience. Please take a moment and subscribe if you're not already subscribed. We're like so close to 200. It's just painful sometimes to see and be like, we could be at 200 tomorrow. But until next time, keep on comparing and contrasting. Here's a doggy bag of things you can use for your life. You want some soul tips? You want your soul to be better?